Men are more ready to repay an injury than a benefit, because gratitude is a burden, and revenge a pleasure. Tacitus. With you now hanging by your own weight on the cliffside, Atticus was able to lift himself back onto the ledge just as the others led by Justus arrived to pull him up. Justus was then lowered down by the others, and his strong arms grabbed you and pulled you up with ease. That evening, the goat was a welcome meal which put back much of your spent energy. As the others went off to sleep, Justus was again sitting in his usual brooding and contemplative position. You were determined to find out the nature of what had been troubling him, as it was obviously more than just your current predicament. You finally asked what had been troubling him these days. He looked at you with eyes that continued to contemplate some past event, so you turned to leave Justus to those thoughts.
The Legatus had asked for assistance from the other legions, but assistance was not offered. It is why we marched alone. It is why many more men died than needed to. Should Augustus somehow survive this, it is not something we shall soon forget.
He drifted back to his thoughts, and you left him by the fire, but you now understood that it wasn't just the other legions that had failed Augustus. Rome itself had failed your legion. Your group carried on in a northwestern direction until the distance between you and the Silures was sufficient for Justus. The terrain had become more mountainous, and there had been no sign of other Romans or local tribes. Justus stopped the group before evening fell.
We are now in the territory of the Ordovices, who, like the Silures, have resisted Rome. We should begin to head east to avoid any chance of contact.
As evening fell, the brothers Marcus and Cassius spotted a small farmstead. While your group had more than enough cooked goat meat to last a few more days, your travel had all been by foot. The farmstead offered an opportunity for horses, which would make the travel back that much quicker.
We must be cautious, Justus said. Where there are farmsteads, there will be a hill fort nearby. The hill forts are their source of military might, and we would not stand a chance. We must make our sole task to acquire horses and leave for the east as quickly as we can.
Your contubernium circled wide around the farmstead with Justus in the lead and approached it from a thick patch of forest. The horses were uncomfortably close to the main building itself, so your group decided to wait until nightfall. There would be no fire, only the cold meat of the goat and what hazelnuts were left to eat. Water was also needed, as it had been almost half a day without drink. The clear starlight that evening made the going quick and fairly easy. Your group maneuvered through the forests. You wanted to get the horses while there was still a fire burning in the homestead. With the occupants having bedded for the night, strange noises would be quicker to alert them. Marcus and Cassius now took the lead. As farmer lads, they were more natural around horses, horses that were not accustomed to military use, and would lead the horses to the rest of you waiting just outside the clearing. Your group got close to the edge of the clearing as possible to keep an eye out for Marcus and Cassius. You could just see their outlines in the moonlight as they approached the farmstead and the horses to the side. Then Atticus let out a concerned gasp as dozens of dark figures could be seen surrounding the two. You immediately moved forward to get a better grasp of the situation when you too were surrounded by dozens of what you could now see were clearly Britons. You instinctively reached for your gladius, but Justus stayed your hand.
Not now, lad. Let us see if we can reason.
Within minutes, your group was bound and led towards the homestead, where both Marcus and Cassius were also sitting with arms bound. Torches were being lit, and you caught your first good glimpse of the Britonic tribesmen. Unlike the Siluri, they were painted with various shades of gray and green, and yet spoke to you what sounded much like the same Britonic tongue that you'd heard near your home fort. However, they looked much more battle-hardened, and based on appearance alone, theirs was a life of almost constant conflict. He who appeared to be the leader of the group moved forward and began to speak Britonic. He had an aide to his left that translated what was said into a broken Latin.
We have been watching you for the last day since you crossed into our territory. It is clear you were at the battle with our neighbors to the south. Our leaders will want to question you. Pray to whatever gods watch over you, Romans, as your time on this world will be short. With the words delivered, there was no pause or look for a reply. The men around you simply tugged on your bindings and pushed you in the direction of the homestead. You were given some water, but no food, and it became clear they were doing just enough to have you survive for questioning, and not much else. When dawn broke, they marched you the 2 hours to their hill fort. It was an impressive structure for Britonic standards, whereas the Britons to the east had built forts on higher ground, and you'd even laid siege to several the first 2 years upon your arrival. These were built differently. Rather than simply sitting atop the hill, they had concentric circle embankments that ringed the fort. In all, 5 such circles provided additional defenses to the structure up top. The other main difference between the hill forts you'd seen in the east and these were the high stone walls and mostly stone buildings. And what wooden buildings sat within its grounds were covered with dried mud so as to not easily catch fire, whereas the hill forts in the east had been primarily wooden structures, which did not take long for your Roman siege tactics to capture. As you were led up the winding path to the fort and into the structure, you passed by many grim-faced locals that looked upon your group with obvious disdain. Your group was placed in a cell with a tiny barred window through which there was no fresh air, only the smell of human and animal excrement. It was overwhelmingly strong, but the least of your current worries or concerns. Cyprian, Quintus, and the rest sat expressionless. To have escaped from the Silures and survived these rugged lands to end up here, it wasn't stated, but you were all thinking the same. All of you, except Justus, who spoke softly through gritted teeth. We will likely be interrogated in the morning and executed by evening. We will have one shot, and even that will likely not be successful, but I'll be damned if I go to Elysium without a soldier's death. You would have thought, reflecting back on this years later, that after the flint and tinder incident, your contubernium's faith in what Justus was capable of would be without question, but his words just echoed the hopelessness that you all felt. Your legs were bound at the ankles and arms behind your backs. There would be no one shot, no matter how hard Justus willed it into being. The sounds of things being thrown over the wall and landing in a splash on the hillside near the small window were heard periodically. This was followed by the ever-present smell of excrement that rose and ebbed after each toss, but never subsided. After several hours and with darkness cutting off any natural light that had found its way through that small window, footsteps could be heard coming closer, guided by flickering torchlight. 2 Britons with a small bucket of water entered the cell. They placed the bucket in the center of the room, laughing. One then began to urinate into the bucket of what was to have been drinking water for your group. What happened next has played in your mind on many future restless nights. Perhaps the events transpired slightly differently, but in those remembrances, they always played out the same exact way. Justus had, before they entered the cell, moved his bound legs to his left and placed his back against the bars of the cell. When the second guard who stood closest to Justus began his urination, Justus swept his mighty legs swiftly to his right, taking the feet from under the guard and sending him crashing headfirst into the bars where he crumpled to the ground still. As the second guard reached for his sword, Justus had already squatted straight up with his bound feet centered firmly beneath him. In the next instant, his battle-scarred forehead smacked into the left temple of the guard with such force that bone was heard to split. The Briton's body swayed unnaturally to the right before falling prone headfirst onto the hard cell floor with a sickening thud. Instinctively, but several seconds behind Justus' swift movements, you inched towards the sword, which was hanging half out its sheath on the fallen Briton. The first Briton was now beginning to come to, but Justus, jumping as high as he could with those still-bound feet, came crashing down upon the Briton's head, ending any recovery. Justus next lowered himself back against the wall and brought his bound arms under his buttocks and to the front of his body. He next grabbed the sword you had by now freed, but could not manipulate, and sawed free your hands. Within minutes, you were all free of the bindings, but still prisoners of a sort. Quickly, mules. The excrement was being tossed from above. That will be our exit. Quickly, Justus whispered forcefully. The hallway from the cell led to a stairwell which wound up to the main level floor. It appeared empty save for some Bretonic spears which you all grabbed. Your group quickly found the opening in question, which in actuality was an open balcony above where the cell window had been. As your group began to make its way towards the ledge overlooking the hillside, a dozen more Britons stormed into the building. Justus blocked the entryway and turned, yelling, "Run, mules, now!" None of you was going to leave Justus alone here, and you all rushed the doorway. The next instant, a Briton spear was thrust clear through Justus's midsection, but he continued to try and block the doorframe. You all pulled him clear, and a disciplined rage took over your group. Here, atop the hill fort, the room became a Roman battlefield, and years of training took over. The Britons moved without discipline as individuals, but your unit functioned as a group, each thrust deliberate and timed. After the first three Britons fell, the rest had the look that you men knew well. The look of men no longer certain about fighting with odds turning against them. A look that would lead to what happened next. Individual instinct for self-preservation. The Britons turned. And you all knew as they turned and fled, they could not be allowed to leave. And to a man struck each down with savage ferocity. While you had fought with discipline, the rage was still present. Perhaps even a bit of this island far from home was now a part of each of you. With the Britons dead, you turned back to Justus, who was now bleeding profusely, and three of you tried to prop him between yourselves.
"Leave me, mules. I've not the strength, and will only slow you down."
This was your centurion, and there would be no counter-arguments.
"I've also not the strength myself, so grant me death. Now, quickly!"
As the de facto leader of your contubernium, you were the one tasked to send Justus to Elysium. It was no easy feat, but there was no time for any ceremony. However, none of you would leave him here. No Britons followed you as you scaled down the hill. Perhaps that was what was left of them, with the others having gone to fetch yet another tribe or some others, but it was of no consequence, as you looked only forward to make as much distance as you could. Your group carried Justus between you. The plan was to return to the farmstead for the horses. While it wasn't spoken of again, when your group reached the farm, the occupants were not spared. Justus would be burned, as was tradition among your people. You would make it to the rendezvous. Just under one quarter of the legion had survived. While the ranks would be filled over the next few years, word would spread among the survivors of the other legions abandoning Augustus to their fate against the Silures. This would come back to haunt Rome's legions here against the Iceni in the decade to come.